from the wall of blue that seemed to have gone up immediately following the Mike Brown shooting to the subsequent grand jury decision, many are left relieved, confused, and angry. But emotions aside, it's important to look at the legal nuts and bolts of the case. She's joining us now to help make sense of it all is prominent trial lawyer, co-host of nationally syndicated radio program Ring of Fire, Mike Papantonio. Always amazing to have you on, Pap.
Yeah,
great. So, Pap, in 2010, in over 160,000 federal grand jury cases, juries declined to indict only 11 times, although this was a state grand jury. Why do you think it didn't follow the same trend?
Well, you've always heard the saying that you can't always get what you want, but that doesn't hold true for a prosecutor, Abby, in front of a grand jury. It's a different scenario. In front of a grand jury, a prosecutor gets exactly what he wants. That's what's different about Ferguson. This prosecutor, right out of the box, if you recall, the first time he gave a speech, he showed us that he wanted to indict the news reporters, he wanted to indict social media, he indicted protesters, he indicted critics, but he had no intention from day one of indicting Wilson in this case. It doesn't take an experienced prosecutor in front of a grand jury to accomplish that. Abby, he used some textbook methods. There are some very, very much some textbook methods that this man used in front of this grand jury. One of them is that you dump as much complex data and testimony and evidence in front of the grand jury as you can without ever helping them draw inferences about what all of it means. It's called data dumping, and you see it in complex trials all the time, and he just happened to use it in front of this grand jury. And then, of course, you put in these experts, these forensic experts. You cherry pick them, the best experts you can find. You put on a dog and pony show on complex issues like blood spatter patterns or gunpowder residue, and then you mold the most favorable narrative for exactly the result you want. So that kind of answers your question why the numbers look so out of kilter here. The real trick is this guy did not want an indictment to begin with, and it's very clear.
So interesting there. And given what you've read in the transcript and about the forensic evidence, how do you judge the validity of Wilson's story?
Well, I mean, he was well prepared. His lawyers worked for hours with him because they realized that what he had to do is he had to prepare the tone. When he went into that jury room, he had to prepare the tone for the entire story. And then once he prepared the tone, it was treated like Dalai Lama. You don't cross-examine Dalai Lama. You simply let him say whatever kind of outrageous statement he wants to make. And then when you actually go back and compare, some of the things that he said were completely just fair game for cross-examination, but nobody asked any questions. So it was really well prepared to answer questions. His lawyer spent a lot of hours with him going over all of that. And at best, a lay juror maybe can ask a few awkward, unfocused layman questions about what he had to say. They can ask questions about scientific data from the forensic experts, but they don't understand the concept of cross-examination, and that's the heart of getting to the truth. The real home run was putting him on the stand. I mean, it really was, and never asking tough cross-examination questions.
Let's talk about the prosecutor, Robert McCullough, here. Ferguson residents and politicians, of course, have expressed doubts about his ability to be objective in handling the case from the beginning. I mean, considering all of the attention, why do you think they didn't assign a special prosecutor?
Because they wanted this result. That's the only thing you can conclude. There was no harm in getting a special prosecutor, getting a special grand jury. The problem that you have with this prosecutor going in front of this grand jury is he has relationships with them. He doesn't have to say anything. They can pick up the nuances of what he wants to accomplish. They understand his social ideology, his political ideology, his moral ideology. They've been in front of him. It's a relationship that for sure was going to bring the end that he wanted. So they didn't want that to happen. I mean, I don't know why the media is so unwilling to say that. They did not want any type of mandate or indictment here. They could have done something as basic as involuntary manslaughter, and then we could have had a trial, Abby, where you actually have cross-examination. You actually have real lawyers who do what I do for a living, and that is to build the case by way of cross-examination. And it would have been out there. People could have seen what really happened instead of this very well choreographed presentation that we saw this guy take. Look, you can read, we've read it, you can read the transcript. You can't tell what's going on, the nuances. It's like a wink and a nod sometimes with a witness. It is the emphasis that you put on a particular forensic expert when you give him the qualifications and you talk about who this person is. It's all smoke and mirrors, and that's what this guy used from day one. That's why he didn't want to give up his chance to be that chief prosecutor in this case.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point that people don't really realize, is that we're talking about just a trial. This was not a verdict. This was not handing down guilty or innocent. This was literally saying, should a person who shoots an unarmed man be put on trial? Mike, let's talk about the National Bar Association. This surprised me. I mean, they issued a press release yesterday stating that it will be calling on the U.S. Department of Justice to pursue federal charges against Darren Wilson. What are the chances of that, and what kind of charges do you think they could levy?
You won't see anything happen from this Department of Justice, Abby. There's just no... Look, had he shot up a bank, maybe we would see something take place, but no bank was shot here. This was just a human being, and this is a Justice Department who is not going to do... They're not going to do anything. If anything's going to take place, it's going to be by way of a 1983 action, a private lawsuit for wrongful death. It'll be brought by by Darrell Parks and Crump. They're already the attorneys working on this case. And then we might actually have the chance to see a real trial. So, and that's the best we can hope for.
Thank you so much, attorney, co-host of Ring of Fire Radio. Thank you so much, Mike Papantonio, for always breaking it down.